Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome the Editor-in-Chief of Energy Foresight, David Weston. Hi, David. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone. Good morning. Thanks, everyone. Thanks, Sasha, for hosting this event so expertly over the 2 days. Building an effective electricity market design is vital to ensuring the energy transition stays on track. There needs to be the rules and regulations in place that guarantee a secure supply of electricity, that protect consumers from end users and from high prices, and that accelerate the shift to a low-carbon economy so we can limit the effects of climate change. These goals are much easier said than done, and discussions across Europe and beyond on how to do this are as numerous as they are complex. My name is David Weston. I'm Editor-in-Chief at Foresight Climate and Energy, the essential read on the global transition to a decarbonized economy, and one of the co-hosts of the What Matters podcast, so check that one out. Over the next hour and a bit, we're going to continue that conversation with a panel of experts who I hope will be able to provide a little more sense and provide some insight into the electricity market design, where it needs to improve in order to adapt and solve the energy trilemma. There will hopefully be opportunities towards the end of this session to ask questions to our panel, so do have a think of what you'd like to ask them. And there will also be some poll questions, as Sasha said, on Slido, so please have your phones at the ready. Before we delve into the topic with our esteemed panel, I'd first like to welcome Claire Waysand, Executive Vice President and General Secretary of Engie, to set the scene a little bit for us. Claire, thank you.
Okay, good morning, everybody. And well, it's a pleasure to be here. I think Leo told us yesterday that Eurelectric was the place to be. And I would argue that this panel is even more the place to be. It's the place to be in the place to be, as member states are currently in the middle of heated discussions on market design issues. So congratulations for being here. And a big, big thank you to all of you, and especially, of course, to my co-panelists, which I'm delighted to be joining later on. And of course, big, big thank you to Eurelectric for putting extraordinary topics on the table. So there is a bit of echo, no? Or is it only on my side? No? Okay, that's good. Okay. So let me start this morning by a few messages that I want to share on market design. First message, Europe is our most precious asset. When you think of it, the European electricity market is really a good example of European integration. It has proven its value, it has proven its robustness in extraordinary times that we underwent last year. And it has enabled all of us to ensure security of supply and has been instrumental in our capacity to face this incredible shock. So first point, let's make sure that while we take into account the different energy mix choices across Europe, the future market design preserves European integration and preserves the well-functioning of the European market. Second message, we are in a situation where we are all aware that our energy market and our electrical landscape, more particularly, will have to be drastically transformed in the years to come. At Engie, we made public a few scenarios, both for the European system as a whole and also more specifically for France, and we looked at how to decarbonize Europe while minimizing the costs and while ensuring resilience of the system. And I must say that we were lucky to have Emmanuelle with us. What these scenarios show is that electricity demand is set to almost double by 2050. Among this electricity demand, renewables will have to cover the bulk, roughly 78% in 2035 and 90% by 2050. What does it mean? It means that wind and solar power generation need to increase as they never did. Wind by between 3 and 4 times by 2035 and 6 times between by 2050. That's for wind and solar. So huge acceleration of renewables and huge acceleration of electric renewables. So this is something that needs, of course, to be taken into account. We will need a framework that enables this massive growth in renewable. With the development of this renewable in electricity, we will also need the way to face the intermittence that goes with it. So we will need to invest in flexibility technologies. The flexibility technologies such as battery storage, pumped storage, CCGTs with more and more decarbonized gas, there will be a need for huge investment in this area. Our estimate is that we will all have to increase these flexibility capacities by almost 4 times by 2050. So huge acceleration in electric renewables, huge acceleration as well in flexibility. At Engie, we are a very big actor in electricity, but we are also an actor in gas, and very convinced that we will have complementarity. We will have complementarity, and alongside these green electrons, we will also need green molecules, biomethane, and of course, decarbonized hydrogen, and molecules produced out of hydrogen, e-molecules, that are, of course, produced ultimately out of electricity when you think of low-carbon hydrogen. They will have to play a key role in hard-to-abate sectors, and in particular in heavy transport and some industrial uses. The demand in hydrogen and in hydrogen-related molecules will explode. Of course, it comes from a relatively low level, but our estimate is that it will have to increase 8 times by 2050. Roughly three quarters for transport and 1/4 for industrial sector. So huge electrification and huge need to accelerate renewables, very big need to increase flexibility, very big need to increase the production of green gases. And finally, we will need, of course, the infrastructures, and we will need an integrated vision of the energy system, both in terms of complementarity of the different energies and across countries. And here I'm coming back to Europe, our most precious asset. We will need this integration and this integrated view to minimize the costs of energy transition and also to ensure the resilience of our systems, ensuring that peak demand and energy system flexibility are managed as cost effectively as possible. So this being put in place, what do we need in terms of market design? Well, quite easy actually to answer. Two objectives: preserve the wholesale functioning of the European market and accelerate energy transition. Well, the objectives may seem simple, then what comes next is of course more difficult and subject to heated debates. But first conviction, we need a clear framework for investors to accelerate their investments in renewable electricity. Here, we are thinking in particular about long-term PPAs, private contracts between consumers and producers. They are an excellent tool, and they provide both visibility and predictability to both parties. So when you think about the need to help the market have visibility on both sides, they are an excellent answer. They work at this stage better with larger consumer. So one question we could have is to make them accessible to a wider range of customers, which would probably require some kind of mechanism, some kind of public guarantees to encourage their use to a wider range of customers. That's for PPAs. And of course, together with PPAs, and that's also part of market design, contracts for difference, which are state tools, could also play a very useful tool. On this broad design, we have to be mindful of the fact that the devil will be in the details. And if these mechanisms are well-tuned, they will accelerate energy transition. If not, they could be detrimental. And the risk we all need to avoid is mechanisms that would be not well-tuned and that would provoke a wait-and-see attitude from the investors. So the basic bricks are here. Let's make sure that whatever is done works and works for investors. Second, we also need mechanisms to support flexibility in the system, to ensure the robustness of the system. And here, I'm thinking about CCGTs running on more and more decarbonized gases, hydro pumped storage, batteries. They will guarantee the robustness of the system in a time of intermittent electric renewable energies. So they should be supported, and that should be part of the design. It can't be something that's ignored, thanks to a remuneration mechanism for ancillary services and simple, attractive flexibility capacity mechanism. Finally, the question of price and consumer, of course, is important. And here, we need a system that will both provide the right signals for energy efficiency, but at the same time, which will reduce the exposure of customers to price volatility. I think a number of you are, we are all living in different countries. Some of us have been shielded by government protections, others have experienced, including very personally, what it means to be exposed to very volatile shocks, volatile prices of energy. We all know by now that changes in prices of energy can be very erratic. And so while price signals are important to push for more energy sobriety and energy efficiency, which will be key to energy transition, there is also clearly a case for reducing the exposure of customers to these erratic fluctuations. So here, PPAs and CFD clearly have a role to play. They are mechanisms that give long-term visibility not only to the producers, but also to the customers. They have a role to play together with other tools and government tools and policies in particular. I'm thinking in particular of all the measures, of all the tools that will incentivize customers to increase their energy efficiency. This will be a good way, of course, to reduce the sensitivity of customers to price variations. Suppliers also have a key role to play, of course, in particular in the schemes they offer to customers. And here, the main message is that ways should be found to better protect the consumers, in particular against unreliable suppliers or unsafe behaviors from suppliers that we've sometimes seen in the crisis, while preserving a framework that guarantees stability and competition. So finally, last point. At Engie, we are a big electricity producer and firmly engaged into the transition into renewables. We have a target of 50 gigawatts worldwide by 2025 and 80 gigawatts by 2030. So that's worldwide. We're also, of course, very active in Europe, including in our home market, France, where we are the first developer in terms of wind and in terms of PV. Together with this ambition in electricity, we have a strong ambition also in flexible assets and also in green gases. So in a way, we have a broad view of the energy system and how it evolves. And what we know and what we experience on a daily basis is that while there are many non-price aspects that are key to accelerate transition, such as permitting, such as the rapidity of network connections, such as also supply chain resilience, what we also need as businesses is a framework, a market design that will help us maximize our investments, building confidence through stability and through simplicity. So in short, we need a framework that simplifies, that will be stable, and that does not complexify. So with this simple message in mind and execution to be followed, we very much welcome the contribution from Eurelectric to the debate. We think it's a great piece of work, the recently published study and policy recommendations that go with it. And most importantly, I very much welcome and I'm looking forward to this panel discussion. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Claire. Please take a seat on the panel, and I'd like to welcome our other panelists for this session. Maria de Graça Carvalho, MEP and a Shadow Rapporteur for the revision of the electricity market design in the European Parliament. Albert Riera, Advisor for the Cabinet of the Secretary of State for Energy in the Spain's Ministry for the Ecological Transition. Emmanuelle Wargon, President of CRE, the French regulator. Paul Voss, Director General of European Aluminium, and Derk, Swider, Vice President of Energy Economics, Policy and Foresight from E.ON. Please welcome them to the stage. Lovely. Thank you very much. Just as the speakers get settled, I'd like to introduce our Slido polls. So please grab your phones out now and we'll take a look at those. We've got two questions that we want to hear your thoughts on, and I will also put these questions to the panel. So the first one, Slido's, you can hopefully see the, oh, there it is, get out of the way. Okay. In your opinion, what is the most important pillar to ensure a market design fit for net zero? Is it a strengthened consumers' engagement and protection framework, an enabling investment framework for renewable and low-carbon technologies, a more forward-looking adequacy framework to meet future system needs, or all of them, all of the above? Just while the audience are putting in their thoughts, perhaps, Albert, maybe we could start with you there. What do you make of this question? Which of these options would you recommend?
All of them?
All of them. I think so. What about Derk?
Well, I think I would pick the second.
Okay.
So we heard about the acceleration need and speed. So I think most of it will come with the investment framework that we find.
Very good. Emmanuel?
I would say all of them, but I think they are working together because it's all about long-term signal. So if you give long-term signal, you both give visibility to invest in renewable, and you also protect consumer.
Very good. Paul?
Yeah, I'm not sure how to distinguish between the second and the third. They seem, anyway, they're both very important. We need lots and lots of, we need lots of renewables.
Maria?
They are all interlinked, and there's a balance between the, all of them. Yes.
And Claire, what is your thoughts?
Well, at the risk of being not original at all, I concur with my two previous women panelists, all of them.
Perfect. Let's see what the audience said then. Let's see if we can see the results come up. Yeah, everyone seems to agree with you on the whole, but I guess the most important one of the three is enabling an investment framework. Excellent. So there's a second question very quickly then that we'd love you to hear your thoughts on as well. Out of the long-term contracting opportunities, which do you believe will bring the most cost-efficient deployment of renewable and low-carbon technologies to reach net zero? PPAs, which I know we'll talk to Paul about, voluntary two-sided CFDs, which Claire mentioned, or forward contracts with adequate liquidity? Maybe Claire, can we start with you this time? Which of those options are you most interested in?
It's all of them, but it's not only about, I mean, it's not so much about cost efficient, it's more about visibility to the system and stability. But with this caveat, so I would have redrafted the question.
Sure.
but then I would answer all of the above.
All of the above. Maria?
I think PPAs, we need all of them, but I would give priority to push PPAs and to make sure that they are accessible to all partners, including smaller market participants.
Yeah, Paul, as I say, I know PPA is quite important for the aluminium.
Literally desperate for more PPAs.
Yeah. Right. Emmanuelle?
I think we are past the moment when we are asking, do you prefer A or B? I really do think that we have a global systemic reform to do and that we desperately need long-term signals, and all of them are going to give long-term signals, especially including forward contracts. So I would say all of them, because you need a whole long-term market with different tools which are adapted to different uses.
Mm-hmm.
I really like to see that forward contracts are on the list. I think in the discussion, we haven't heard about this option so much, so maybe we can discuss about that later. I find the CFDs quite important because I think they attract a lot of investors, and in order to reach the speed levels that we need, that's a good option. But I think I would click like most on the all of the above.
All of them again, although to be honest, although we would like forward contracts to be able to incentivize new entry, we are a bit skeptical as to whether we will have sufficient liquidity in the coming years to incentivize investments that must, you know, record their investment in 20 years, and these forward contracts maybe have liquidity up to 3 years. So right. A bit skeptical on that.
Absolutely. Let's see what the audience, see if the audience agreed. Yeah, again, mostly all of the above, but I guess of those options, PPAs, there you go, Paul, are the perhaps the most cost-efficient deployment. So interesting. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for taking part in that poll. Really interesting discussion, market design, obviously very broad, as Claire said in her intro. We've had a bit of an update this week with the Energy Council meeting on Monday. Perhaps I could begin with Albert very briefly on that. Can you give maybe a little bit of an overview? What came out of the council? Did you see the Energy Council and what they agreed and perhaps what they didn't?
Yes, I mean, we are a little bit disappointed that an agreement could not be made on the market design file, on the EMD file. But nevertheless, I think that we must recognize that the council under the Swedish presidency has advanced a great amount of work in just 3 months. And it seems that the agreement is not far away. So let's hope that, you know, best of luck to the Swedish presidency. Let's see if they can close it within the next 10 days.
Mm. Maria, are you confident that they will be able to do something in the next 10 days? And could you give a state of play on the EMD and the remit negotiations, perhaps?
Yes, I was quite happy with the remit agreement, being the rapporteur of remit. With the remit agreement yesterday in the council and the advancement on the electricity market design also in the council, and I hope that in the next 10 days they can finalize that file. On the European Parliament, we are also advanced quite a lot. We are pushing the two files at the same time, treating a bit like a package. So we will have the vote on the EMD on the 19th of July and on REMIT in the, I think, 7th of September. We had several shadows meetings, and we have started with the easiest points, and we are advanced quite a lot in the easiest part of the reports and things that we have compromised, and we have advanced in several topics like shift pay, the peak shaving, like the energy communities, energy sharing. So quite a lot of topics that we have already find an agreement. Of course, the big points of this agreement will be left to the end. It will be more difficult, like the cap to revenues. And I want to ask you to draw the attention. I received a note for this panel that says that in the European Parliament report, there is the inframarginal rent as proposed by the European Parliament report. that is not a fact. The report is not yet voted, and right. until it's voted, the proposal is the commission original proposal. So right. It's just a correction. That is important correction.
Of course, absolutely. Emmanuelle, maybe we could touch on you. We're speaking a lot about European policy and coming out of the council and out of parliament, but then it's up to the member states to implement some of these regulations. Could you give a little insight in from maybe a French perspective, how you go about implementing these new policies and regulations into the national framework?
Sure. On the remit part, we are quite happy with the general orientation, general approach of the Commission, because we feel it's balanced between ACER, the European agency, and the national regulators, and we are fully willing to implement it. On market design, what the current regulation is doing is opening a kind of big toolbox that each member state is going to be able to use. So, as you know, the French position is widening the toolbox as much as possible, including the very touchy political discussion about CFDs on existing assets, which could namely be referred to nuclear, of course. So, we are very keen on it because we want to have a possibility to implement it. And we have specificities on the French market about this. So our point of view as French regulator is we need a strong national regulation to find the balance of powers, the balance between supply and demand. How much money do you put in supply so you get the investment? How you protect demand so you protect competitiveness and you protect consumers? So all the tools which are opened by the regulation will be used, and we will have 6 months of work at French level to make sure how we use it. But we want regulation so we have a level playing field and an open market.
Maybe I can bring Claire in here. As from a, you then, once it gets down to the national government level, it's up to Engie and people like utilities to sort of do that work. Are you excited by what's coming down the pipeline out of the Parliament and the Council?
Well, I think overall the text that was originally put on the table was rather balanced. We see the very difficult discussions, including the one Emmanuelle mentioned on the regulation framework for existing nuclear assets in France. What I can say on this from a supplier standpoint is that we are in a situation where we have one actor, one electricity provider that provides 70 to 80% of the electricity on the French market. Right. So it makes sense that there is a special attention and regulation for this actor. And as supplier, we want a system that ensures a level playing field between suppliers to make sure that there is room for competition on the French electricity supply market.
Absolutely. Derk, maybe I can bring you in here on all of these issues. And do you see the proposals coming out of the European Parliament and then obviously at national levels? Are they going to solve this LNG trilemma? Are we going to be able to secure supply, protect consumers against high prices, and also still advance the energy transition?
Well, I think they get us closer. So when we look back at the discussion that led to the proposal from the Commission, the discussion was included very fundamental changes of the overall market design, changing away from how the wholesale markets do operate today, so from this famous hashtag merit order system. I'm quite happy that the proposal, as you said before, is quite balanced on that point, and that we address those bits and pieces that need to be addressed in order to get to that net zero world. I don't think that all of the topics have yet been addressed. So I'm happy really with the CFDs and PPA logic, although I think, as I mentioned before, that sometimes it's forgotten that when you sign a PPA, it's an OTC contract between a company and someone who builds the renewables. And the idea from the renewable developer is to secure investment with that, right? To make it bankable as a project, which is good. CFDs can do a similar thing. But the difference is that when you make sure that the volumes flow back to the markets, they are in the markets. If you give people an incentive to still go to the market, and not only to the wholesale market, so the spot, but also to the forward, it gives a potential to protect customers, which is one of the big things we do. We have 48 million customers, and we have a very liquid forward market in Germany, especially. So we hedge our position. So we make sure that we lock in the prices once you sign a contract, which helped us to navigate quite well through the crisis and gives us resilience. So I think this element of making sure that the electricity that is produced comes to the market sometimes is forgotten, but I think it's very important, either be it PPAs, CFDs, or other measures. And the thing that I think I have to say now was missing a bit is on the need for adequate resource capacity, so that we do have backup capacities in the system in the longer term. So in Germany, we talk about 25 gigawatts of additional capacity that was supposed to be gas. Now it's supposed to be hydrogen, or at least hydrogen ready. But we need obviously investment security in order to get it happen. And I'm quite pleased that now we do have a discussion about capacity markets, which I think is one missing element, or was a missing element. Should not open the discussion again on all emission levels and so on, but I think this piece now being integrated is quite vital in order to achieve that net zero target.
Claire, you were not along there. You're seeing the same sort of things in France and Belgium and wherever.
Yes, we are across Europe, sure. And yes, I just wanted to concur very much on this. Yeah. I think the missing piece at the beginning was a flexibility mechanism, capacity remuneration mechanisms. They need to be considered as part of mainstream tool, because the reality is that we're not going to be able to succeed in energy transition unless we have that kind of mechanism. So it's an absolutely key piece of the puzzle, and very happy to see it back in the picture.
Paul, perhaps we could bring in you here as a heavy industry, a big energy user. Are these rules and regulations good for you guys as well, as a heavy electricity user and a heavy energy demand industry?
Look, I think it's encouraging that we see discussion about what to do moving forward. I mean, I maybe spend a couple minutes on what this energy crisis has been like for us as an industry. I have at home a small dog who is blind and kind of crazy. And a couple of weeks ago, she fell into her water bowl.
Yeah.
And one of the kids found her blindly splashing around and turning around, trying to figure out how to get out. When I'm asked, as I frequently am now, about how we're navigating the energy crisis, I'm reminded of the dog. And you could say she was navigating her way out of that bowl, and we're doing the same thing. I mean, it's been an enormous struggle. We've lost 40% of our production capacity. The euphemistic word for it is curtailing. But basically, we're talking about stuff closing because it's impossible to do business anymore that way. And you know, you could, if I weren't in the business, I think I would probably say, well, if this requires so much electricity, maybe we shouldn't be making it. But the problem is, in order to get a renewable-based system, one driven primarily by solar and wind, one that's able to support the shift to electromobility and so on, you need vast quantities of aluminium. That's non-negotiable. So I'm encouraged by any discussion about how to make the electricity market function in such a way that we can retain our industrial base here in Europe. I think that should be a shared priority. It's not just a narrow commercial interest. We need to be able to keep making stuff in Europe. And in order to do that, we need clean and affordable energy.
But how do we go about that when we've got to balance the need for industry, which have lots of demand and want secure prices and things like that, but we also want to maintain the liquidity of the short-term market for utilities and everyone, making sure that there's still a fair market for consumers and end users that aren't quite so much?
I think we need to do a lot of the things that my colleagues up here have been discussing. I mean, first of all, we need a massive increase in the volume of renewable production. We just need this infrastructure built, and none of it's coming quickly enough. And then we need a much more flexible market design. We need PPAs backed by a flexible market that can help us overcome the storage problems. And I see anecdotal examples where this model is really, really working. I see smelters that had to shut down that are now talking about reopening and will be powered on the basis of renewables backed by PPAs. But the problem is those are more the exception than the rule right now. I get really excited about a particular case, but it's still a drop in the ocean compared to the scale of what's required. So I think the direction of travel is good, and I think it's probably a positive thing that we've avoided the temptation to kind of throw the entire market design in the bin because we had a crisis, and be a bit thoughtful about the way that we do this, because I don't think that it's fundamentally wrong. I just think that the scale and scope of the work is probably not yet commensurate with the scale of the challenges we're facing.
Absolutely. Emmanuelle, could you perhaps provide some insight in how the regulator's role has changed off the back of the crisis? Have you seen a shift in what your action is?
Sure. For me, the key words of the whole topics are mix, speed, and implementation. Mix, because we really have to accept we need complementarity of many things. Complementarity in decarbonized electricity, renewables and nuclear. Complementarity between energies, electricity and gas and hydrogen. Complementarity between the supply side, the demand side, and the flexibility. Then it's all about speed. How quickly we can do all this speed and speed of implementation. Because what is interesting about market design and the current role of regulators is we got out of the big theoretical debate. Do we like the current market or do we want to throw it away? To get into a more concrete topic. But we are still discussing a lot about general targets and how this picture is going to be marvelous and in 10 years and in 20 years and in 50 and 30 years. We have to get this thing implemented. And as Claire was telling us in her introduction, the devil is in the details. Right. So for a regulator, I joined as a regulator a little less than a year ago. And it's not a good period to join as a regulator. Because basically you have to learn how we did things over the past 20 years, the previous language, and then you have to learn we can't do this anymore. We have to invent a whole new ball game. So this is challenging, but the most difficult part is keeping the balance between the huge need of investment, meaning you have to pay more money on production, more money on infrastructure. And nobody is going to pay for it because you want to protect consumers and you want to protect competitivity. So where is the money coming from and how you balance all this? This is our big challenge.
Off the back of the crisis, there are a number of emergency measures that came in to help limit the short-term impact of the high prices. Derk, do you think there needs to be, were there any of those emergency measures or temporary measures that perhaps hurt the recovery, or are there any that perhaps we need to keep long term?
Before I address that question, please allow me to just echo what I just heard, because I think it's so important that we indeed do not only focus about ever new targets. The targets we have are good, and we can always discuss about increasing the targets, but it's really about the implementation. We really need to speed up, and we see this in our business everywhere, where most of the renewables are connected to the distribution grid, which my company operates and builds, and it's really hard to keep track, right, to really manage this implementation. So it's not only about the investment, the capital that's needed, that's sure a topic. It's also about just workforce, just getting stuff done. So that that really is a challenge, I think, upon all of us. So we will see quite some growth in all our businesses, I think, due to that. But this implementation is really what we need to get on. So be quick in your decision making in the policy arena. Give us the means to then do the business that we can do best, because if we do have guidelines and the framework, we can do and we will deliver. I think that's core. On your questions with regard to the crisis measures, which ones to keep and which ones maybe not, I think we are still sort of in a crisis, so we're not sure yet how we can come through next winter. So prices right now indicate a lot lower tightness in the markets or expectation of tightness than last year, which is good. But I think we should not just assume that it's all gone. I think we did a lot to make us a lot less dependent on Russia with all the potential LNG gas imports that are now possible, which also I think is a very good development, but we need to be careful. I think I'm one of the several here today who complain a bit about that it is warm, but actually that remembers me of our energy saving activities that we did last year. And I think it is important to continue to do that over the course of the year. Of course, not only on electricity and air conditioning, but also on heating. But I think this is good. If this settles in all our minds that we value electricity and gas use, I think this is key. On the more policy measures, I'm not so sure if we, we think have certain price caps in place that still protect our customers. Which I think should be in place until at least the next winter. And from there, we have to see if that's still something where price level really reach a level where customers need to be protected. But I think we also need to work on those measures that allow us to really hatch the positions that we have and make sure that overall the price exposure to customers is lower.
Maria, maybe we could just quickly touch on next winter. Obviously, we navigated the most recent winter. We were lucky it was maybe quite mild, so it wasn't quite so as energy intensive as it could have been. Are there plans, again, for next winter from the European Parliament and the Commission that can, so we can navigate perhaps a more harsh winter, or do you think it would be much the same as last year?
One point that I would like to stress is that Europe had a fantastic behavioral reaction. So we have started with a high dependence on Russian gas, 45%, and in very short time we reduced to less than 10%. And also the saving, energy saving in general, and in particular in gas, was fulfilled the targets that the Commission has proposed and the Council has agreed. So that is gives a note of optimism. I want to stress two or three points that I think it's very important that we keep in the electricity market design that will help us to solve the winters in front of us. One of them is to keep and to strengthen the European energy market. European electricity market. We cannot afford to have like we had in the past winter 14 different emergency schemes, 14 different caps with different rules. So we really need to have the legislation European wide. And the second, we need to have an infrastructure that goes with it. So we still do not have a completely infrastructures, for example, on electricity that connects Europe. That is one point. Second point that is very important for me and for my political group is to create the conditions for investment. We really need, if we want to be competitive, we need to give the investors the right signals for investment. We keep saying, look at what is happening in the US, and when we have the possibility to do a framework that gives the right conditions, if we misuse it, it's not right. So we are including in through amendments a framework to strengthen the investment on also not only on production but also in grids, distribution, transmission, interconnections, and that is important for us. And we are removing any barriers to investment. So it's one of the reasons that I'm against the cap for revenues, because that has proven, and we have data for Europe and for some member states that shows that the investment has almost stopped during the time that we had this cap for revenues without very few beneficial. We also have data of some member states that shows that these revenues were much smaller than they were expecting. So if we want to be competitive, and if we want to do this transition correct, right, this is probably the biggest public intervention in the modern history that we are doing in Europe. So we really need to do it right. And one of the points to do it right is to give the conditions for investment. We need to be very careful when we mix policies. We are talking here about aid for industry, industrial policy. Many times we have discussion on social policy, and I fully agree that we need to have a strong social policy in Europe. But is it the correct place to do it in the electricity market to protect the consumers? So we need. Yeah. Usually, when we mix policies, we do it wrong, because every policy needs to be done correctly in a separate way with the objectives. I'm a public service all my life, from national and European. Policymaker, and it's something that I have learned, and we need to be very careful when we do that.
Absolutely. Claire, you had a point on sort of next winter.
Yes, I wanted to say a word about next winter. I think the good news is that the situation has much improved compared to last year, and that's true both on the gas front and electricity front. So that's very, very good news. I think all of us, we've been able to diversify away from Russian gas,
sure,
and to ensure security of supply in gas. If we look at gas situation and gas storage, which has now become a widely popular topic, we know that the gas situation is very good at this stage. We are more than 60% full, I think, in Europe right now. So what we see is a situation where we are confident that the storages should be almost full by the beginning of the winter season, which will provide us with some security, of course.
Sure.
Doesn't mean that it's a given. There's always the possibility of further tensions, but in a normal scenario, we should be able to face next winter in reasonable situation. Doesn't mean that there are no tensions, as I was saying, and what we see indeed is a lot of volatility on the market. While the prices of gas in particular have gone down drastically, they are still quite volatile. So that's for gas. For electricity, we also see more availability, and that's in particular in France on the nuclear front, and that's good news. And we've seen prices that have receded. What I want to share is two things. First, I fully agree that we need to remain vigilant, and we need to keep the behaviors, in a way, the energy efficiency, the savings that will be needed for energy transition while avoiding demand destruction and curtailment, as is said in an understatement way. I mean, we want to make sure that we're able to have competitive
energy for Europe, for the businesses, to maintain the production. And second point, we need to avoid policy overreaction. I think one of the lessons of the crisis last year was that, in particular on the gas market, what we've seen in the summer, when the prices went as high as 300 euros per megawatt hour, was largely due to interventions by some governments. So let's make sure we let the market players ensure security of supply, giving them the overall framework, and that's probably the way we're going to be able to achieve the next winter as well as possible.
Absolutely. Very quickly, I know, Emmanuelle, you need to rush off to catch a train. Just finally, if I could give you one question. What would you like to see next? What is the next big thing that you want to see discussed and talked about and solved in the energy market, as from a regulatory?
I think we should look deeper into the demand side and the consumer side. On this side, first, there is a value on visibility. Reducing volatility of prices will help anyway, especially for companies and big investors. Yet the redistribution part to households have not been tackled so much. It's discussed over the EMD regulation. Is it a possibility to redistribute to everyone, or can we make differences? But what is the kind of price signal which is acceptable for households? Up to what level can it go? How much do you want to shield them or protect them? And how much do you infuse changes of behavior? I think we focused a lot on the supply side, both on production and grid and infrastructures. And we take for granted that we will manage to reduce the demand, both on the industrial side and on the household sides. But this has to be accepted. I mean, I understand the applauses when you say social policy don't have anything to do with energy policy, but if it's not accepted, it's not going to work, and then you will have political overreaction. So I think this side should be looked at in a little more deeply. And I have to apologize, I have a train, so I will have to leave this great panel. So thank you, and thanks for this great opportunity.
Okay. Thank you, Emmanuelle. Thank you. Paul, you wanted to jump in there from the consumer side, I guess. Yeah. How do we protect consumers?
It takes a lot to upset me. I'm a calm, patient person. A few months ago, I forget which one it was, but one of the communications from the Commission in the middle of the energy crisis, when we were talking about gas at 300 euros a megawatt hour, and in the coming months, I read a phrase that really did upset me. It said, industry is already beginning to adapt. And this was part of a good news story. And, you know, closing the gates and sending home a few thousand employees is a kind of adaptation. It's certainly a reaction. You can describe it that way if you want to. But, it's a little bit tone deaf. And when I hear discussions about how we managed to get through the winter and how we managed to manage our demand, as a private citizen, of course, I'm pleased. You know, I have friends and family like everybody else, and I want people to be able to manage and want people to get through. And I feel sometimes, working for a big industry, I feel uncomfortable drawing attention to the problems that we might face. But there are social consequences for industry collapsing as well. You know, it's hard to tell a sad story about big companies, and I'm not sure how much people want to hear it, but it's also not really good enough to say, oh, look, we've adapted. Particularly as I think, okay, everything was happening so fast, it was difficult to manage, but these things can be managed better. You know, aluminium requires, as I've said, a great deal of electricity. That means also the potential to supply some significant flexibility to the market, because one thing is to completely close the operation and shut the doors. Another is to temporarily reduce demand, but in an orderly and predictable fashion. This can be done, could have been done, but it requires, rather than coming after the fact and saying, oh, you know, your business is closed or your business is just about to close, you know, here's a bit of money to help. It would be infinitely more efficient for us, for the regulator, for the market, for the customers to come to us and say, we're going to need you to reduce your capacity by this much at this stage, and we can start to plan. These things can be managed better than they have been, and I think that dialogue between major consumers like our industry and power suppliers and regulators is important and can help us get through not only this coming winter but the next ones with less destruction, you know, to us. But ultimately, that's not, I don't expect anyone to really care about that, but we can start to think about the consequences for the society in which we operate.
Albert, maybe I can come to you here. How do we go about protecting consumers and end users? And from maybe your point of view, working in the government, how do you balance that without making such big overreactions that the utilities and energy industry players are warned against?
Right. So perhaps I would distinguish between the short run and the long run.
Sure.
I think that in the long run, if the existing proposal is implemented effectively, then we will achieve that in the sense that in 10 years from now, a lot of informational generation will likely be on the CFDs and PPAs, and therefore consumers will naturally be hedged. The issue is, meanwhile, while we get there, what do we do if we have another price crisis as deep and as long-lasting as this one, let's say in 2 years' time? And here, perhaps, it's useful to extract some conclusions from the emergency measures that have been implemented during this crisis. I think that the first conclusion is that the EU was not ready to face such a deep crisis, and that's why member states had to improvise and implement all these sorts of different measures which were implemented differently in different member states. And so this was sort of effective at mitigating the social and economic impacts, but at the same time we must recognize that we have created regulatory uncertainty. And so what we have to do now is to work on solutions that remove this regulatory uncertainty and we get back consumer and investor confidence. And the question is, how do we do that? And I think that there is only one way, which is to find credible solutions that member states can implement during the next price crisis and that they are effective and sufficient. And here our main worry is that subsidizing electricity tariffs might not be a credible solution, particularly if those revenues have to come from the fiscal space of the different member states. That might be a sustainable solution for some member states that have a huge fiscal space, but for others, I would say the majority of them, that might not be a sustainable solution. So I think that we are not removing regulatory uncertainty yet, and maybe we need to rethink on how to do that.
I'd love to open up to the floor to see if there's any questions from the audience for our excellent panel. If you have a question, please raise your hand. Anyone? There's one in the middle here. There's just a microphone coming. Please introduce yourself as well.
Yes, thank you very much. Joorsten Blanca, I work for Eneco. We're an integrated energy company with activities in the Netherlands, Germany, and Belgium. I agree with the panel that the deal that is still negotiated on the electricity market reform is getting into a very balanced direction. There's one element that is still concerning me, which is energy sharing. We've all also agreed that speed is really important. There's a lot of work to be done. But energy sharing will create a whole new set of complexities for both regulators, but also DSOs, also the energy suppliers. In our company, we will have to set up a whole team to just implement all the IT changes that will be required. And the question is, who will bear the cost? Those benefiting from energy sharing, or will it be socialized to all the consumers? Or will the energy suppliers have to bear those costs? So I would like to hear your view on energy sharing. Do you see that as a risk or an opportunity?
Maybe Derk, can we start with you on that one?
Well, I personally see this more as an opportunity in several markets. I share your concerns also about how to distribute costs. But engaging more people in the energy transition is good. What I think we need to make sure is that there's some way to use the flexibility that they provide or that they do have, and still include them in the overall transition. So, echoing your point, make this, I think, is not just for end customers something, just making sure that we can access the flexibility in the system is key.
Claire, what about from your perspective on energy sharing?
Are we talking about curtailment in the demand of energy? I'm not sure I got the question, actually.
Article 50? 15A?
Are you not? Okay, so I'll go back to the text, and then I will answer you bilaterally. Thank you.
Paul, what about from an industrial perspective? Lots of synergies potential between heavy industry and other users.
It's one of these things that I'm sure we view it positively for the reasons that have been stated. I think that the scale of our demand might limit the scope to provide a solution. I mean, I could answer as a private person. I put solar panels on the roof at home, and I'm delighted with them. The remuneration scheme became a lot less generous about an hour after we got them installed, which is probably fair enough because I think Belgium was probably overpaying us for them, and that's kind of something we have to live with. And I'm pleased they're there. The kids see them, the neighbors see them, and so on. Difficult to be opposed to this, but I don't see it powering a large metal production facility.
Yes.
Yeah, so now that I have understood what it is
Thank
about,
you, Maria.
And thanks a lot to my neighbors, I think the overall direction of the electricity market is that there will be more decentralized solutions, and certainly electricity communities will have a role to play in the picture. They're also part, by the way, of the ownership. We talked about, well, we didn't talk that much about the acceptability issue and the fact that, but Emmanuel, I think, talked about the need to embark citizens. I think that's a good way to embark citizens, also relying on very local solutions. So they do have a role to play, of course.
Maria, how about from your point of view, are there discussions happening?
Yes, is one of the points that we have already find an agreement between the political groups in the parliament. Actually, I have introduced some amendments strengthening the role of the energy communities. I think that is a tendency that is in the future very important, starting now, that of empowerment of people, and is important. Of course, the question of the cost model needs to be developed. But it is something that will continue to develop.
And maybe Albert, very quickly on from a Spanish perspective, quite an interesting sort of environment there. Energy communities and energy sharing probably quite important for many of Spain's citizens.
Yeah, we already have instruments in that regard. We have self-consumption through the network and other arrangements. On the energy sharing question, I think that it's an opportunity. But we should be careful not to create sort of legal loopholes under which different agents will perform the activities typically done by retailers or generators without having the same obligation. So we need to make sure that that doesn't happen, because that can be a big risk.
Any final questions? One down the front here. Just wait for the microphone, please. And down here, please. And then we'll come to you very quickly. We're running out of time. So please be quick.
Hello, Vijay Betanbarla from SLB. I lead the power segment there. Question, when you're considering market reforms, how are you taking additional build out of transmission into account? Are there some things that you can do to incentivize the build out of transmission within regions or also interconnecting different regions?
Yeah, absolutely. I guess I'll come to the sort of utility power companies for this one, Derk. Transmission and incentivizing transmission, I guess.
Well, I guess you're pointing to do we need to other measures in order to balance the system overall? I mean, in general, I would say as soon as you see different price levels in the different markets, there is a sort of incentive. So right now we see a lot of additional capacities being thought about in order to balance the European system. And I think also in the future, Europe as a whole will be the solution. I'm not sure if we need to incentivize this more other than making sure that we attract the investment, which comes from the regulatory side, where we need to make sure that there are good remuneration schemes, which I think is key, which is challenging as inflation did increase, interest rates are a lot higher now. So we need to make sure that that all those investing into grids, be it transmission or distribution grids, do have the right incentives to do and continue to do so, and be economic in a way in that. But I'm not sure if we need more than that, to be honest.
I agree with this, and I think that's an excellent question, because as we all know, in the cost of energy transition, the investment into networks is going to be a very, very big part. And we are talking before about the cost of investment and who is going to bear it. I would argue at the end of the day, it's the economy that's bearing it, regardless of the mechanism that is put in place. So we need to make sure that we have the sufficient infrastructure investments. We know that it's going to be tens of billions of investments into electric transmission that will be needed for transition. And by the way, that's also a good reason to make sure that we have complementarity between electricity and gases, because you already have gas networks and they can be adapted at relatively much lower costs than the investments that will be needed into electric transmission. But a key point to energy transmission and to avoid the bottlenecks in accelerating the renewables.
Just wait for the microphone and then everyone can hear you.
Yeah. As we know, transmission build-out has a longer lead time, right? The markets, the supply side can move really fast and then cause additional challenges. I understand the incentives within the market reform itself to send the right price signals for the different locations, but there's also the lag, time lag in kind of being able to build out the transmission. But thanks for the great answers.
Maria, you want to make a quick point?
On the transmission and in the interconnections, we have put a set of amendments, and there is something that we are very much in line with the rapporteur, so it will be, I hope, in the final parliament report, to have a framework for investments, for investment in the grid. That part is the economy, but part is also through European funds, special in the interconnections between the different countries, the cross borders, like using the regional funds and the transnational network funds for that. So I hope that is a strong chapter in the final European Parliament report.
Thank you. I'm afraid I think that's all we have time for today. If you have any more questions, please do grab any of our panelists out in the coffee area or around the event for the rest of the day. Thank you very much for listening and taking part, and I'll pass back to Sasha for the next session. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you.